Can you hear me now? Well, welcome everyone. This is great to see. This is a packed fellowship hall tonight. Thank you for coming. This is Grace Fellowship's 55th missions conference, and God has been good. God has been good to allow 55 years of this church supporting missions. But I want to open tonight in prayer. Father, thank you again for this time together. Thank you for the people that have come out tonight. And thank you for all the missionaries that are attending tonight and the safe travels. And Lord, we just thank you for everything. We're so thankful. And Lord, we pray tonight that you would be glorified in this missions conference as as we celebrate the gospel going to all the world, and we also understand the world that we live in, how there are lots of people that haven't even heard the gospel, and lots of people that disregard the gospel message. And Lord, I just pray that tonight and in this missions conference that you would give us encouragement, that we would encourage the missionaries as they encourage us. And in Jesus' name, amen. So tonight I want to begin by introducing our missionaries. We have Sam Bruce. His wife Carrie couldn't make it, but we have Sam Bruce. Where is he? Way in the back. All right. He's with Ethnos 360. And returning for his second year in a row, Bob and Hope Carter with SIM. Thank you, guys. And then we have Scott and Gail Kohler with Wycliffe Bible Translators. And Eric and Ellen Peters with Pioneers. Bill and Carol Turner with Team. And we have Grace Fellowship's homegrown missionary, Andrew and Chantel Underwood with Nexus International. And speaking Sunday, we have Jay and Beth Weaver. Thank you. This has been such a blessing to have everybody attending this conference. We also have some local people. Actually, only one of them is here. We have Philip Lane. Unfortunately, Andrew Lane couldn't be with us tonight. He's has an illness, but we'll see a video that he made today for his presentation tonight. And Leanne Walther with Rockingham Council of Bible Education is also out for illness, and Pat Apple will be doing her presentation. Now I want to honor our wonderful missions committee. Our vice chairwoman, Claire Gunter. Our treasurer, Karen Steger. Our assistant treasurer, who will be taking the role of treasurer next year, BJ Clifton. We have Pat Apple, she coordinated where all you missionaries are staying. We have Denise Brooks. Mary Southard. And Kent Steinbeck, who's not here tonight. But we also have three new additions to this missions committee. We have Patrick Patel, who's joining this year. Ross Jones, I don't believe he's here tonight, but we have Will Jones. So last year was my rookie season at being missions chairman, and I never introduced the theme. This year, I'm going to introduce our theme. Our theme is to know Jesus and make him known. And I was thinking about a Bible verse to go along with, you know, to know Jesus and make him known, and nothing was really coming to mind, but one day, a couple months ago, after we had already decided on the theme, I was just doing daily reading, and I just started reading the book of Acts. Of course, the book of Acts is all about the Holy Spirit empowering people for the spread of the gospel message, missions work. Jesus said in Acts 1:8, and it worked, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." But the thing that really, of course, that's a really popular missions verse, but the thing that really jumped off the page was actually in Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost. It starts out, there was a sound from heaven like a mighty rushing wind, and people gathered together in the upper room and were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking with other tongues. This sound caused a crowd to gather. We know it was quite a significant crowd because at the end of the chapter we read that 3,000 men, that's not including women and children, but 3,000 men were added to the church that day. That is a huge crowd. And it's on this crowd that I want to focus a little bit. So, you know, the crowd was, you know, they were hearing the people in the upper room praising God in other languages, and you know, they're speculating, you know, what could these things mean? And Peter gets up and addresses this crowd. And in verse 22, he says, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know." When Peter mentioned Jesus of Nazareth, that crowd knew exactly who he was talking about. There was no doubt. When Jesus was walking through Jerusalem, I bet one of the people in that crowd could have pointed out and said, "There's Jesus." And I bet he doesn't look anything like the pictures that we see today. They probably even knew what Jesus liked on his fish fillet sandwich. They saw the miracles. I wonder if anyone in the crowd was fed by the 5 loaves and 2 fish, or maybe had leprosy healed, or was blind or lame. The point I'm trying to make is these people knew Jesus, but did this knowledge save them? People we talk today will say, "Oh yeah, I believe Jesus was real." James, the half-brother of Jesus, wrote in James 2:19, "You believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble." Even Satan and his demons know Jesus is real. Are they saved? To know Jesus, to know Jesus is not just to know about Jesus. So when did this crowd go from knowing about Jesus to actually knowing Jesus? Peter said in Acts 2:36, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." The crowd's response when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said to them, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you, to your children, and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call." So let me ask you this. Do you know Jesus? Do you realize that it was your sin that crucified him? Do you see that it was God's love for you that he gave his only begotten Son? Is he both Lord and Christ, King and Savior of your life? Do you understand that when you believe in him, not just believe he was real, but when you believe in him and his work on the cross, you have eternal life? Is that not something that should be made known? There is some truth to Phil Spector and the Teddy Bear song, and some of you are around back in the 50s to hear this. To know him is to love him. To know Jesus is to make him known. While we may not all be called to the office of being missionaries, we are all called to do missionary work in our little world, in our jobs, in our homes, on the golf course, even at Walmart. While we may not all be called to be evangelists, we are all called to evangelize. We may not all be called to be prophets, but we are all called to proclaim God's word. So the challenge for all of us, including me, for this missions conference, is to sit at the feet of Jesus and to get to know him more. Listen intently to these missionaries and get to know Jesus through their testimonies. See how he is working through their lives. Let it be an encouragement and motivation for us to make Jesus known in our own little missions field. So let me introduce you tonight to our first speaker. He's very tall. Mr. Philip Lane.
I'm going to take this off the stand because Nick said I could. Thank you guys for having me. I'm super excited to be here and just to share a little bit about what I did this summer and the work that I've been able to be a part of for the past 4 summers consecutively. My brother Andrew, he was also going to come with me, but he got sick, wasn't able to make the drive up. So he sent a video in, which we'll see later tonight, but he's really sorry that he couldn't be here in person, but he's super excited to tell you about the trip through his video. So I was in Brazil, in the Northeast interior. Like I said earlier, this is my 4th year going and working with the missionaries that are partnered with the church I grew up in, Community Baptist, and are connected with my youth pastor and stuff through there. I'm going to show you just really quick where we were, because a lot of times when people think about Brazil, they think about instantly, you know, Rio de Janeiro or São Paulo, like one of the really big cities in the south, or the beaches, or they think about the Amazon and the jungle and the rainforest. And all of that's true, but we are in, if you look on the side, you see a little yellow state called Bahia. It's above the purple Minas Gerais. So we are in the north part of Bahia on a river that has also been dammed up to make the largest man-made lake in the Western Hemisphere. And we're in the interior desert. So a lot of times when I tell people that, they're like, Brazil has a desert. Brazil has a desert. It's not just rainforest and beaches. Bahia is the poorest state in the country. So there's just a lot of poverty, a lot of need, both physical, material, and spiritual. So what we do is we try to meet those people where they're at and provide all of those. When we get there, going down to Brazil, it's not like a 2-hour flight to Florida. It's a hike. It's a trip. I think pretty much every year I've gone, it's taken around 24, 25 hours in total travel time just to get there, because we can't fly direct to where we're going. So we have to fly into a bigger city and then take a connecting flight. The second thing on this slide is weekends. So on the weekends, we go to this interior town called Lages. And Lages is where the missionaries that we partnered with have planted a church on the interior, and it's really small. It meets in a house. It's around 8 to 12 people normally will show up on Sunday night for service. So we go there, and we work in that city and in the surrounding communities around it, where they've been able to do like Bible studies and other ministries, such as like they go and play soccer with kids, with some of the local Brazilians that they're partnered with. So we do that on the weekends. Petrolina. So Petrolina is the biggest city that's close to us. It's around probably 500,000 people. And right beside it, I don't have a good U.S. example for this, but there's a river that goes straight through the city, and one half is Petrolina, and the other half is Juazeiro. So there's a church that works with our missionaries and the missionaries that they're helping to raise up domestically, called Esperança, which is a Baptist church in Juazeiro, which helps to equip missionaries domestically as well as to serve the community in the city around them. So they recently opened a new campus in Petrolina, which is what the MVP stands for. It's a new campus in Petrolina. So it's a second campus of their church, and they've done a lot of outreach in the city. Like the slide before, which I can go back to. This was, we went and did a huge like soccer camp on one night. So there were, as you can tell, a lot of kids. And it's really well organized. They go and meet, start playing soccer by age groups, by jersey color. And then at the end, everybody gathers around and they're really attentive and they're just there to hear what you have to say. And it's been really, really successful for them and to see their church grow. A lot of the ministries we do now revolve around basketball. The Brazilians love basketball. It's on the rise. Like, everybody thinks about Brazil. They think about soccer. That's so true. Like, they are really, really good at soccer. But there's a love for basketball that's growing in the country. And that's been a really easy gateway, at least for me, to slide into. So in this picture, there's me and then the guy on the other side. His name's Caleb. I played basketball with him my freshman year in college where I was at in Kentucky. So he came with us this past summer, and we were able to just, like, reach a lot of people through basketball that the missionaries we work with otherwise probably wouldn't be able to reach demographically. In the second picture, you can see on the my far left, there's a dude, his name's Felipe. And I met Felipe my first year going, and we talk all the time. We're in contact constantly. But Felipe, through, like, basketball and all of this, he's begun to be more open to the gospel, to where he talks to the missionaries we work with and some of the other people who are there, because he has questions and he wants to find his answers, and he's really, really open to hearing about Jesus, and that's really, really encouraging. The last slide that I have is Pedro. So Pedro is one of my best friends. He serves as a translator. You can see him, he's giving me a haircut in that picture, and he translated for us when we played basketball in Lages. But the reason I put this slide up is Pedro went to a seminary in Brazil down near São Paulo in the south, and he graduated, and he's getting married this March, which is really exciting. And then he's moving to Lages to become a full-time missionary there. He's partnered with Esperança, the church that I mentioned earlier, and the missionaries that we work with. So our missionaries planted that church, and Pedro and his wife are going to come and take it over and help it grow and give our missionaries an opportunity to go somewhere else and start something else. So what that looks like for Pedro so far in the time that he's been there, has he cuts hair for a living. That's how he makes his money. So he cuts hair, and through that he makes a lot of connections with guys our age who want to get nice haircuts. So Pedro, he'll fade you up, get you right, and then he'll tell you about Jesus while he does it. He's super, super intentional. Like, I've never met another person who's as good with people as Pedro. Like, he'll walk up to random dudes in the street and just throw his arm around them and just pat him on the chest. And it's like, I would never do that. Like, I'm not doing that to some random person. But Pedro, like, he's just a big people person, and it's helped him to reach a lot of people. So super excited just to be able to, like, partner with Pedro and see where he's growing and, like, the work he's going to be doing. So that's what I have for the slides, but I just wanted to say thank you guys so much for the support that you've given me over the past 4 years. I know Andrew feels the same way. It's a really big thing just to have a church backing you financially and just by prayer, and people who genuinely care about you and want to see you succeed on these trips. So thank you guys very, very much. I'm going to turn it back over to you.
Okay, how's that? Obviously, I'm not Leanne Walther. I wish she was here. But as Jonathan mentioned earlier, she tested positive for COVID last night. And for the past 2 to 3 weeks, I've kind of been in touch with her back and forth as she has been thinking about what she wanted to share tonight. And she would run ideas by by me, and we would talk. So I had kind of heard about this, and she had prepared a PowerPoint, and she said, "Pat, I'm not going to be able to be there, but I think you can share." So it for me, it's a privilege to work with Rockingham Council of Bible Education to be a board member. And in the fourth and fifth grade, I started, I heard was my Bible teacher, and God used her in a mighty way in my life. And how many of you here had Bible in the public schools under Carolyn Ray or another teacher? Wow, that's amazing. So, and tonight, I'm really excited to introduce you to our newest teacher. Kim, would you stand up? This is Kim Moyer. She is teaching at Rockingham County High School. I'm a little nervous. And her mother is here, Wanda Moyer, and any of you who went to the Y for years, Wanda worked at the front desk, and she is a very special lady. So many of you are familiar with Rockingham County Council of Bible Education. And I am really thrilled to say that our church has supported this mission for a long time, which is quite a privilege. You may know that there is a Bible class in every high school, middle school, elementary school in Rockingham County. But you may not have heard that last year, through the Bible program, 440 high schoolers, 707 middle schoolers, and over 400 fourth and fifth graders heard the Bible taught. And Grace Fellowship has partnered with RCBE for many years. And this is Leanne's presentation, and a verse came to her mind, "Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." The first two words, steadfast and immovable, mean the same thing, to be in a fixed position and unmoved by anything that comes along. It reminds us of a firmly planted tree that is not blown over when the winds come. When a ministry has been going on for a long time, and it is amazing to know that Bible has been taught in the Rockingham County schools for over 100 years. That is a long time, and praise the Lord. It can be difficult to remain steadfast and immovable and abounding in the work of the Lord. And there are several reasons for this. Number one, the task is big. Here are the schools from Western Rockingham, but there are the nine other elementary schools, and then if you count in all the middle schools and all the high schools, the work looks so much bigger than the numbers we are reaching. The task is big. When you start something new, it's easy to let excitement carry the motivation for the work. But when you've been at something for a long period of time, it's easy to start looking at the size of the task and feeling like all of your labor in the Lord is so small. There's another reason why it can be hard to remain steadfast. The enemy is relentless. Scripture says that Satan roams about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he can devour. And we can see, all of us, the ways he is doing that through the culture wars and the educational system itself. Our students aren't even aware of what they're getting. We see so many broken families and kids who are forgotten. There's the rise of witchcraft and the occult. It just seems to be darker every day, and even in milder forms, in New Age, meditation, and yoga. We see these kids getting so many deceptive media messages from movies and the internet. We see how students are facing peer pressure to do wrong. All of that is terrible, is bad enough. But remember, each one of these students was born with a sin nature, just like ours, with the desire to go their own way in stubborn rebellion. That looks so discouraging. And what is Satan's end game? The souls of people. But isn't that God's end game too? That he is seeking to save the lost. There's another reason why it is hard to remain steadfast and immovable. On your table is a little white bowl, and if you will pass that around, and there are seeds in that bowl, and each one of you take a seed. The seed is so small. After seeing all the things the enemy is doing to destroy souls, how can these tiny, tiny seeds of teaching the Word of God on the Bible bus and in the classroom make a difference? On the Bible bus, it meets every 2 weeks at an elementary school. So there are about 16 lessons for the year. This is an aside. Before Leanne joined RCBE, some of the Bible committee members had been praying for someone to come to do a scope and sequence for the Bible program on the bus. And in the way God works, he brought Leanne to hear about the Bible program and to apply for a job on the Bible bus. And that is she had a major in that. And after she began teaching and we talked to her, she did a scope and sequence for her, because there's the fourth grade and the fifth grade go on the Bible bus. So fourth grade is 1 year and fifth grade is the next year. So we have a 2 year scope and sequence. And she did an amazing job doing that. And it's just like God to do that and to provide something that we had prayed for, to have a good plan for what would be taught on the Bible bus. But every time you go to an elementary school, you have 45 minutes for the fourth grade children and 45 minutes for the fifth grade children. That includes the time of getting off the bus, going in, getting the students, taking them back to the bus, driving the bus off campus, singing, hearing the lesson, learning the memory verse, then driving back to school and getting them back to classes. For the year, if there are no cancellations due to trips to Washington, D.C., fall festivals, whatever, snow, all the other things that happen, that is a total of 12 hours for a fourth grade student to be on the Bible bus and a fifth grade student to be on the Bible bus. So when we compare that to all they're facing, it would be easily to become overwhelmed and discouraged and think that what is being done is insignificant and would never make a difference. There's one more final reason why it's hard to remain steadfast and immovable. The task is big. Oops, sorry. The results are unseen. And we get to hear a Now we might get to hear according to God's word or hear someone sharing a testimony about what the Bible bus and what he had done on the Bible bus meant to them. But the fruit that remains won't be seen for another 20, 30, 40 years from now. And that makes me think of a great example of Carolyn Ray. The Bible program throughout Rockingham County is built on the fruit of her labors 20 to 50 years ago. She never got to see what we have seen God do in the past 20 years. The Bible was only taught at Reedsville. And then it expanded into the Rockingham County High School and Middle School, then into Eden, and then into Western Rock. Over the past 20 years, that is what God has done. And she never saw any of that. So if you see the big job, the enemy's relentless tactics, the small seed, and no long-term results, it's easy to become discouraged or think that what you're doing isn't having much effect. But think of prayer. To say that the work of prayer is vital is an understatement. If you've ever wondered what you can pray for, here are some suggestions. Attendance and attentiveness. This year, our Sunday school class prayed that for attendance, for more fourth and fifth graders to sign up for the Bible bus. And at the beginning of the year, we had 270 students who had signed up ahead of time. That's the most that had ever signed up, which was an answer to prayer. But some schools, they have very low attendance. For instance, at Huntsville, there's only two students in the fourth grade. Now, it will grow. More students will join as the year goes by. But at some schools, we have 20 in the fourth grade at the beginning of the year. And so pray for attendance and also for attentiveness of students. Leanne tells the story of, and you can volunteer and help on the bus, but Leanne tells the story of one student who was looking down and he would not pay any attention whatsoever. And the helper on the bus was in the back of the room, and she just really fixed her gaze on the back of this little boy's head and began to pray. Leanne observed this from the front of the bus, but as soon as this godly lady began to pray, that boy lifted his head and focused on Leanne and began to listen. So attentiveness is huge, and attendance. Also, pray for the bus and the bus drivers. Sometimes the buses break down. One time it broke down in a graveyard where at Huntsville you cross the road and you park in a church, and it's the little dirt road is right beside the graveyard, and the bus broke down. And so they had to cancel class. So we pray for that the buses will be functioning, and for the bus drivers, for God to provide bus drivers. And for the teacher and their preparation for their classes and for health. And when I saw that, I laughed because I thought, yep, Leanne needed prayer for her health since she had COVID and couldn't be here. But and finally, to pray for favor with the principals and teachers and the school board and the superintendent in Rockingham County. You know, it's interesting. Some schools have a large number. Some schools, the fourth and fifth grade teachers really push the Bible program and going on the Bible bus. And other schools, not so much. And that can really affect attendance. So thank you for praying for that. And finally, remember, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord.
How you guys doing? You all right? It's going to be tough following all of that, so I apologize that you get me last. I also think that it's kind of a mistake to give me this late in the evening. I know that all of you guys are tired, but I just feel the Lord really doing something, and he has just been stirring this in my heart for months, and I'm just not going to let it go, and I'm not going to apologize for that. I promise I'll have you out of here by midnight, if that's all right. All right. So I usually make good on my promises, and this one I think I can keep. But I first just want to let you know, again, my name's Andrew Underwood, and my wife, Chantel and Judah, they've already left. Judah was getting pretty tired, and so she just took him home for bed. But we'll be around all weekend. We'd love to see you guys and interact with you. And for some of you, you know, we don't get to see that often, and some of you don't know at all. And we'd love to continue to build these relationships. But we work for an organization called Nexus International, and the goal of Nexus is that we want to help churches start and sustain movements of disciple making. And we do that through the long-term investment in indigenous leaders within the church. And we just have a huge passion for young people. We want to see churches become next generational in their orientation. We want to see discipleship as not an activity or something that they're doing, but as a cultural element of their church. And we do that in our region that we serve in is in East Asia. Actually, on Tuesday, I'm getting on a plane to go to China and Taiwan. And so this is just our rhythm. We live in Johnson City, Tennessee, and get the pleasure of living and being a part of a fellowship and community there while we serve with leaders in Asia. And we couldn't do that without your support. And actually, you know, I think back on my time growing up in this church and what this missions conference has meant to me and my journey. You know, I walk in through these halls as a young person, and you see the tables and you see all these really interesting things from all over the world. And I just remember in my mind and in my heart that just inspiring me with a lot of a sense of adventure and wonder. And then you meet these missionaries and they're so faithful and you see their courage, and that's inspiring. And I genuinely think that it had an impact on me as a young person. And so I thank you for your faithfulness, 55 years of faithfulness, of letting this be a part of your rhythm as a church. And that it's not just some random thing that we do, that we get together and we hear about these stories, but it's shaping something in us. It's shaping something in you to gather around these stories, to gather around missions, to stay committed to missions. And so you're not just doing something to the ends of the earth. I think it's really doing something here to you as well. And so I just ask that for this whole weekend, for you not just to see this as kind of a means to something else, but for you to take part in it. It's something that's happening to you and for you as well. And so to participate with this. And so I also just want to say thank you for your support for us. And I intentionally didn't want this time to be about the work that we're doing. Actually, what the Lord's been really stirring in my heart is the theme of this time being to make to know Jesus and to make him known. What is the foundation of the Christian mission? And we need to be anchored into that. And what a better way for us to start our missions conference than to just anchor ourselves into the gospel of Jesus. And so before I get into that, I'm just going to pray for us. And yeah, I promise I'll be as short as I can be. God, we love you, and we just thank you so much for who you are, and that you meet us here, and that we can be in awe of you and the work that you are doing. And we know that as missionaries, we're not taking you anywhere that you're not already at work. And we just simply want to join you in your grand work of redemption. And we love you and cherish you and ask that you would move in us and that we would abide in you richly and that we would hear your word and not just be mere traffickers of it, but we would be partakers in it. And I pray this in Jesus' name. As I mentioned, I wanted to set the tone for our conference by anchoring us in the foundation of Christian mission, which is the gospel of Jesus. Now, this word gospel, we've already heard it mentioned so many times, right? You mentioned it several times standing up here that we want the gospel to be heard, right? We want the gospel to be believed. And maybe we've talked about places that the gospel has not yet reached. And this term gospel, it gets tossed around a lot. We sing about it. We speak about it. We have it written on things. We just use it in our Christian community. And we use it so much that it can run the risk of falling into what we call the lullaby effect. Are you guys familiar with this? The lullaby effect is a very interesting way to describe something that we become so familiar with that we sort of lose its depth and we lose its value and lose its meaning and origin. And it comes from the fact that we have things like nursery rhymes. Are you guys familiar with nursery rhymes? Pocket full of posy. We all fall down. See, I didn't even, like, you guys know this. It's something that you are familiar with. We teach it to our kids. You guys remember it as a kid. It's stuck around for generations. And yet we've lost the fact that most likely its origin comes from the bubonic plague, right? And we've sort of lost the depth of the fact that we teach this thing to our kids, and it's fun, and we play around with it, and it has, now scholars debate this a lot, so don't take my word for it, but it's pretty substantial evidence that it originated in one of the most horrific times in human history, right? That's the lullaby effect, in the sense that we familiarize ourselves with it so much that it becomes unfamiliar. We've lose touch with it. In the gospel, we hear this word, we say it, right? But it has often become a word that we hear so frequently that we maybe have lost a full grasp of its revolutionary power and how impactful it would have been for the first Christians who proclaimed Jesus as the gospel. Good news. And so my goal for us tonight is I would like for us to have that lullaby effect of the gospel removed, and for us to hear it, to feel it, to know it with clearer vision, to feel its revolutionary power, to feel the weight and the depth of it again. And the second thing that that does for us and seeing something clearly is that helps us to identify the counterfeit, right? When we stare and we familiarize ourselves with that $20 bill, the authentic $20 bill, we can notice the fake one. And when I tell you that our world is plagued with counterfeit gospels, our culture is plagued with counterfeit gospels, our societies are plagued with counterfeit gospels, how are we to know if we cannot see the gospel of Jesus clearly? And so how are we to do that? Well, I think context is really important, right? When you first start learning to read the Bible and they give you some good hermeneutical skills, what is one of the first things they tell you? Context, context, context. Don't just take the Bible verse out and read it alone. Read it in its context. So what does that mean? Right? We hear that, okay, let's read it and see it in its paragraph and maybe in the book, or how does that fit into the grand narrative of Scripture? But I actually want to point us to another type of context, which is the context of its original authorship and its original audience. So how would this word gospel been received in its original audience? And I want to look at a passage starting in Mark 1. When Jesus actually uses this word, which I think is interesting in and of itself, and this is going to be our chief passage for the evening. It says, "Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" So here's a few things that we need to see in this context. Jesus is using the word gospel, which in Greek is euangelion. Have you guys heard this before? Yeah? Maybe not. Euangelion, which translates directly as good news. And we get the word gospel from the Old English gospel, which basically is just an Old English word way of saying good news. Right? The euangelion is good news. Why is it important that we see using this word? Why did he pick it? Why did Jesus choose the word gospel? Well, he chose it because it was already a part of the cultural vocabulary of the community that he was speaking to. That in and of itself is kind of mind-blowing, right? Because we often associate the word gospel exclusively with Jesus, don't we? And we need to see that it was not a new or unique concept in the ancient world. And I have something to that I want to read to you that is actually a gospel message that was found just through some good old archaeology. This is really neat. Right? And I'm going to leave out who this is about. Okay? This is really cool. Okay. It says, since Providence, which has ordered all things and is deeply interested in your life, has set in most perfect order by giving us a leader whom they filled with virtue that he might benefit humankind, sending him as a savior, both for us and for our descendants, that he might end war and arrange all things. And since the birth of this leader was the beginning of Evangelion, good news for the world that came by him. Who does that sound like it's about? It sounds like it's about Jesus. Right? It speaks of a leader that was sent by divine providence. I don't know what's going on with this thing. Sent by divine providence. It was a leader who was a savior who brings peace, who ends war, whose very birth is declared as the Evangelion, the good news for the world. Those are powerful words. And here's the twist. This is not an announcement about Jesus. This is the coronation proclamation about the Roman Emperor Augustus, 20 years before Jesus was born. This is called the Priene Inscription. Go look it up if you don't believe me. Let Google tell you. Is that not fascinating? What does that mean for us then? That means that the word gospel was already being used when Jesus came on the scene. What was it being used for? Well, it was being used primarily to announce the birth and installation of new kings and kingdoms. Well, if we know that Jesus is using a word intentionally to speak into a culture that saw the gospel message as an announcement of new kings and new kingdoms, how should we then see Jesus using it? Let me read what he said again. Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. What do we find? What is he doing? What is he announcing? He's announcing the kingdom of God is here. A new king, a new kingdom. Isn't that fascinating? Jesus isn't just picking a word at random. He's speaking perfectly into a culture that would have understood what that message meant. The kingdom of God has arrived. And this is the first thing that we hear Jesus announcing. So whatever the gospel means, use that word, it has to leave room for the announcement of a king and a kingdom. It has to. I'm not making that up. That's Jesus' context for the gospel message. I also think that it is quite fascinating that Jesus is preaching the gospel before his death and resurrection. Now, I want to be very careful here, because do not mishear me that I am making the resurrection of Jesus insignificant, because I am not, okay? It's critical. It's essential. You know, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 that the gospel that I passed on to you as of first importance, also what I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. He says that's a first. I'll take Paul's side on this, right? Jesus is preaching the gospel. If it is only about his death and his resurrection, don't mishear me, then Jesus could have never preached the gospel, which he did. There's something bigger. There's something grander going on. And I'm going to get back to his death and his resurrection in a minute because it is critical. that we see his death and his resurrection in light of the bigger gospel message that is being preached. Jesus' gospel, euangelion, would have resonated in a world that understood it as an imperial term, right? And Jesus was proclaiming the arrival of a new king in a new kind of kingdom, right? And that would have been a huge challenge to the power structures of his world, both Roman and Jewish. I wish I had time to get into that because it is really neat. But that helps us to see why his message was so subversive, right? And why they even wanted to kill him in the first place. Okay. Well, do we see that anywhere else in Scripture? Absolutely. And actually, it took me a little while to just pin down one that we could talk about, or we would be here until midnight, right? I wanted to look at Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 1. It is so illuminating for us, this idea of kingship and kingdom. Paul says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share into the inheritance of the saints in light, has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. Okay, there it is again, showing up for us, in whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins. I'm going to get back to that. Is the image of the invisible God, the form above all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things were held together. He is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn of the dead, and in everything he might be preeminent. For in him was all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. How many descriptors do you need to see the cosmic King Jesus? He is the ruler and authority above all things. There is no corner of the universe that is not subject to his authority, according to Paul. Right? He says, and listen to this, and through him to reconcile himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, has now reconciled. So we've moved from the cosmic down to the most intimate and personal. You have now been reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless above reproach before him. If indeed you continue in the faith, stable, steadfast. We're just talking about that, right? Stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the euangelion, the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed, don't miss this, to all creation under heaven, of which I, Paul, have become a minister. Oh my gosh. Paul puts the context of the death of Jesus in light of his cosmic kingship. We cannot miss that. Paul says we have been moved from a kingdom of darkness into a kingdom of God. I just said a minute ago, whatever the gospel is, it has to leave room for what? Kingdom language. It has to. Paul does it himself. He says we've been moved from a kingdom of darkness to a kingdom that belongs to God, whose ruler is Jesus. Jesus is not just an earthly king. He's not just one of those great influential guys that come around every once in a while. He is the cosmic king of the universe, right? That is really important. There is no corner of the universe that's not subject to his authority and rule. That is really important. And it's important for Paul because he says that he puts his death and his resurrection in direct context to that cosmic kingship. And he says that this gospel is preached to all creation, not just you. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, says that all creation is groaning for the reveal of the sons of God. This whole place is on a precipice waiting for the renewal of all things. And Paul says it right here. That all things, whether on earth or in heaven, are going to be reconciled to Jesus. So, the scope of his kingship, that's important. Right? You remember in The Lion King when Simba's sitting with his dad, he's like, look at all that the light touches, right? The scope of his kingdom illuminates the scope of his work of redemption. I'm going to say that again. The scope of his kingship illuminates the scope of his work of redemption. He is over all things, therefore all things can be reconciled to him. That is really important. There are no boundaries to his kingdom, so therefore there is nothing too far off from his work of redemption. Nothing. There's nothing too far off. His kingdom, not like earthly kingdoms, right? They're not confined. It's not confined to a physical territory or some random political boundary. It is the rule of God over all creation, transcending time and space and realm. Do you feel the weight of that? Is it cutting into your heart? So as we kind of focus in from this cosmic thing, let's look a minute at the death and resurrection of Jesus in context of his cosmic authority, like Paul did. You know, for earthly kings, death is the end. Right? It's the end of their rule. They died. It's a sign of weakness or defeat, but not for Jesus. Even the events of his death point to his kingship. Think about the last 6 days of his life. Instead of being anointed like by a priest, like most kings are, he was anointed by Mary in Bethany. Instead of a magnificent military parade on the back of a white horse, what did he come into Jerusalem? On a donkey. With hundreds of thousands of people singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, save us. And instead of a crown of gold being placed on his head, he had a crown of thorns placed on his. And instead of a golden scepter being thrust into his hand, he was given a stick, a reed. And instead of being raised up on a marvelous throne, he was lifted up on a cross with a sign above him that said, King of the Jews. As these things are not coincidences, what was meant as a mockery of Jesus was his brutal but beautiful coronation. And what no one expected was that they thought was over was not over. Indeed, he was resurrected and exalted by God, declared victorious, right? See, Jesus' nature as king illuminates the meaning of his death, because earthly kings use their power to preserve themselves, don't they? Their status and their kingdom. They expect subjects to sacrifice for them. But in stark contrast, Jesus, the King of Kings, the cosmic ruler of all things, used his authority to sacrifice himself for his people. And this voluntary act of dying for humanity's sins is the epitome of grace and love. Earthly kings don't do that. Don't take my words for it. Here's in Philippians 2, he said, have this mind among yourselves, which in Christ Jesus, who though he was not, who was in the form of God, did not consider account equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he emptied himself by taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name. That's king stuff right there. So that in at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. That's king stuff. And on heaven and on earth and under the earth, that's cosmic king stuff. That every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord. Christ and Lord, those are king, that's king language. The glory of the God of the Father. Through Jesus' death, he was exalted as king. The type of king no one had ever seen before. And this is the critical thing I want you guys to take away from this part right here, is that why is it important that we see Jesus' death in light of his kingship? Why? Because as the king, Jesus has the right to judge the world. That's John 5. That's not my words. However, instead of condemning humanity, he stepped into humanity's place, bearing the judgment that we deserved to give us a righteousness we could never earn. It was his to deal with. He has the right to judge the world. And what did he choose to do? So this choice magnifies the nature of divine kingship as both just and merciful. You cannot see one clearly without the other. His kingship magnifies his death and resurrection. Because it wasn't a powerless surrender, it was a powerful act of intentional love where he chose to endure the cross for our sake. That's Hebrews 12. That's not my words. This reveals that grace flows from the one who has the authority to forgive sins, because he's the one that paid the price. And with his resurrection, hear this, demonstrated authority and kingship over even death itself. There is nothing too far off from his kingship and redemption, even death. So, what do we do with this? Remember, I wanted you to hear and see and feel the weight of the gospel again. That we remove the lullaby effect of it and see it with fresh eyes, right? And I said that hopefully would help us to see the counterfeits, right? Because there are many. And just like the gospel that Jesus preached, it landed in a world where there were already gospels being preached. Remember, that one that I read to you of Caesar Augustus was announced 20 years before Jesus. So when Jesus came on the scene preaching the gospel, other gospels were already present. And nothing has changed. Other gospels are present to this day. And the gospel that Augustus proclaimed, right, he claimed to be what? The savior of the world, the divine savior of the world, that's important, that brought peace and end to war and hope and security and prosperity to all peace people. Every counterfeit gospel in our world claims the same things. Every single one of them. It's going to offer you some path to salvation or some path to prosperity, some path to peace and some path to security, right? I promised my wife that I would be very careful here. I'm going to honor her even though she's not here. But every time we turn on the news, we hear some politician offering to us those exact things. Do they not? And that's not just unique to the United States. Pick on that. Secular humanism offers the same things. Human wisdom, human intuition. Be our savior. It garners our loyalty and allegiance. They beg for it. They clamor for it. They fight over it. That's what counterfeit gospels do. They garner our worship. We're just day after day worshiping at the throne of whatever news persuasion we have or whatever thing that tickles our ears or whatever. We're being discipled by it. We're under its rule. We're under its reign. You don't see it that way because we have the lullaby effect over the gospel of King Jesus, who is the cosmic ruler of all things that stepped into your place. We don't feel the weight of it, so we just buy the counterfeit because it feels good now. Why is it good news for us? This gospel of Jesus is not merely good news for one nation and one generation. Hallelujah, right? It is the ultimate good news for all of existence, resonating with a hope that could only come from the true sovereign of the universe. We can only get that true hope from one place. And so I hope that as we see the gospel with fresh eyes, we don't just see it as this overused word or some kind of buzzword, especially for this weekend, but we see it as a revolutionary declaration of the arrival of King Jesus, who upended the powers of this world and the realm of darkness with his sacrificial love and eternal cosmic authority. Amen? This is good news, that God reigns. And that through faith in Christ alone, we have access to true peace, to true salvation, and from the domain of darkness, an entry into unshakable kingdom of light, where every tribe and every tongue will bow before the throne of King Jesus. So what do we say to this gospel? How shall we respond to it? What does Jesus say to do? What did Peter say to do in Acts? He said, repent, turn around, turn around. Turn around and believe. And believe this good news. Believe that the King has come. Guys, he's come. Stop being so dead. He's come. He's come. The kingdom is here. It's already here. He's come with him. Trusting in this good news, you see, is more than just a decision to avoid hell, right? It has to be. Because it's an invitation to allegiance to a king that offers true life and freedom. This king did not remain distant, but he came near, taking on the nature of a servant, standing in your place on the cross and bearing the full weight of God's wrath against sin. And by his authority over darkness and death, he rose again, so that through faith, you may share in his glory. What earthly king shares their glory? No one. No one. Human kings never do that. This king welcomes you and invites you into an eternal kingdom, a kingdom that has already arrived with him. And so I'm asking you, will you feel the freshness and the weight of this gospel and forsake the counterfeits that so cheaply offer what only the King of Kings can truly bring and live under his reign? I'm going to end with this because I know it's not midnight, so I'm going to end. I promise. And since we're at this missions conference, I want to end with this because this is just an encouragement as we think about what it means to take that kind of gospel to the ends of the earth and every corner of the globe as those who are sent out to bring this announcement. And we can declare this with joy. I'm going to end with this. Isaiah 52 said, how delightful on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, and who says to Zion, Your God reigns as king. Father, we love you. And I pray that we would feel the freshness and the weightiness of the reality that you came to bring a new kingdom of which you are king. And this kingdom and this king in your kingship is nothing like this world, this universe has ever known. And that you have made a way through your sacrificial love that we can belong to it with you forever under your rule and reign. And we don't lose hope. We actually have so much hope because all things will be reconciled to you. And we can live uniquely as people of hope, uniquely as people of righteousness, because of what you've done and because of who you are. And so we declare you as Lord and Christ. And we sit under your authority and we submit ourselves to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Andrew. That was a great message. How many of you ever referred to, when you hear the word gospel, referred it to Christ's kingdom? Like, that's eye-opening. Thank you. That was great. There's a few other people I'd like to recognize tonight. First of all, Nick Stadler, our technical director. The guy is amazing. Thank you, Nick. And then I want to recognize Pastor Mark. We didn't recognize the pastor of this church until the end. But Pastor Mark, thank you. And I also want to recognize our associate pastor, Pastor Tim Barton, who's our youth pastor. And him and his wife, Shelby, starting to get the youth going here in this church. And all I can say is be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Thank you, Pastor Tim and Shelby, for the work that you do in this church, too. And with that, Ken, I got to recognize Ken too. The lasagna that was his recipe, and and he kept this unruly committee in line while I was driving to the airport. So thank you, Ken. And I'm gonna ask Ken to close us out in prayer.
Oh, I pray. I wonder if we could get Nick Stadler to play that Jesus Saves again, and let's all rise and sing it together, because it's something to celebrate. Jesus saves. Tonight, and that's Jonathan for all the work he did to put all this together. Let us pray together. Gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, what a blessing it is to be in your house tonight. Thank you for all of those who've come to be with us tonight and who share with us what you're doing through them throughout the world. We're so thankful for Andrew. We remember very well Andrew growing up in this church so many years, and to see the young man that he's become and the depth of his knowledge and understanding of your word and teaching and discipling, we're so grateful for it. We're thankful for all of the missionaries who've joined us tonight and for all those who've come as guests and all of those who are members here. We're thankful that they're here tonight. Lord, we just pray that we would take this theme of this conference to know Jesus and to make him seriously, because the church will grow through discipleship, through sharing the good news, Christ died for our sins and rose for our salvation. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and grace and for your love, and we just pray now as we go our separate ways that you would be with us, guide us, and direct us, bring us safely back to your house at the next appointed time. In Christ, pray.